Take a look at this map. This is Ptolemy's map of the known world, constructed from his 2nd century work, The Geography. Obviously, it's not perfect. In fact, to our modern eyes, it almost looks like an American drew it. But you can see that, even back in these ancient times, people knew roughly how the landmasses around them were shaped. But how did the Greeks or the Romans or any pre-satellite civilization work out how the world and the landmasses on it were shaped? And just how did they make these maps without the help of a bird's eye view? This video is brought to you by Skillshare. Maps are arguably some of the best things ever invented by humanity. And that's not just me saying that as a geography nerd. Okay, actually that's mostly me saying that as a geography nerd, but still, you cannot deny how amazingly useful maps truly are. Coming in all shapes and sizes, they tell us not just about the world or the universe around us, but how to navigate said world, how said world is doing, or how we thought of the world at a particular time. Now, something at least I've always wondered is, how did people in ancient times work out how these coastlines were shaped? Well, let's put ourselves in the shoes of the ancient Greeks and try to figure out how they mapped the world they knew. So first, where do you start? Well, maybe your first instinct will be to take your map and drawing utensils and sail around all the Mediterranean coasts. And you could easily do that for shorter distances, but for longer voyages, not only would this be unnecessary for getting to your destination, there are also a lot of reasons why this would be a bad idea. It would take way too long, it would be incredibly unsafe if you didn't know what you were doing, you wouldn't always know where you were, it would take too long, you could run out of food, it would take too long, and just tracing the coastline won't always give you the best result. At least not for larger areas. However, you could also survey the land around you, and there are many different ways of doing that. These methods and devices included triangulation, as all you Mapman fans of Mogus will recognize, or zygroma for building long, straight Roman roads, or rope stretchers measuring the flooding of the Nile in ancient Egypt. However, these were more often used for surveying land to build stuff on top of it, and to tax whatever was built on top of it. So you go to survey the local area and... actually, you don't really need to.
Wait, then why'd you just tell me how to do it?
Well, someone's gotta do it for certain areas, but a cartographer's job isn't necessarily to collect all this data, but to compile it together. If you were trying to make a map of the known world in an already established civilization, it's not like you would have had no prior information to work with. With travelers' accounts, navigators' reports, literature, regional maps, and many other sources, many an ancient cartographer made these world maps by simply collecting and compiling all this data, often barely even leaving their hometowns. Anaximander, a philosopher from the 6th century BC, is credited as having made one of the first maps of the world. Anaximander, however, did believe the world to be centered on the Aegean Sea, surrounded by the ocean on all sides, and that this all rested atop a large column. Eratosthenes, a Greek geographer, mathematician, poet, astronomer, and music theorist, born in 276 BC in Cyrene, famously proved what Pythagoras and Aristotle had theorized prior, that the Earth was indeed round. Knowing that the bottom of a well in the southern Egyptian city of Syene, not to be confused with Cyrene, which is near the modern Libyan city of Benghazi, would be illuminated by the sun twice a year, Eratosthenes measured the angle the sunlight hit a well in Alexandria at the same time Syene was under the subsolar point, and using geometry, measured the rough circumference of the Earth and got it almost entirely right. Having worked out the size and shape of the Earth, Eratosthenes then decided to map it out, or at least all the parts known to his civilization. Now, it's one thing to know where all the nearby islands and peninsulas were and roughly how far away they probably were, but just because you know roughly how you need to turn a ship to hug the Italian coast doesn't necessarily mean you'll get everything completely right on a map. But Eratosthenes had a new way of measuring how far apart everything was without actually having to measure anything. He came up with a system of parallels and meridians, very much like we use today, creating a sort of grid system over the world. Thus, if you know a place's longitude and latitude, you can easily place it within the right parallels. And luckily, in Alexandria, he had access to the knowledge of the Library of Alexandria, including travel records, meaning there was certainly no shortage of data available to him. Claudius Ptolemy, born in around AD 100 in Roman Egypt, built on the works of Eratosthenes and other famous geographers of the time to make his own map of the world. One of his most well-known works was Geographia, or the Geography, a compilation of all the geographic knowledge available to the Romans at the time. Like Eratosthenes, Ptolemy used the system of parallels and meridians to place cities in well-known areas at certain points of the globe. Using data compiled from around the Roman Empire, which there was also certainly no shortage of, to determine a place's latitude and longitude. In fact, none of Ptolemy's original world maps have survived to this day, but the instructions for making them have, and thus they are still quite easy to reconstruct.
So, how do you determine a place's latitude and longitude? Well, today you might use something like a GPS, but for thousands of years, we already had our own space-based method of finding where on Earth we were, and all you need to do was look up.
Some of the earliest maps for navigation weren't maps of the Earth at all, but maps of important constellations. Move over, Star Trek and Star Wars, there's a new player in town that's actually already been around for thousands of years, and it's called Star Charts. Navigators can use basically anything that appears in the sky at regular intervals, including the sun, the moon, the other planets, or the stars and the constellations they form. Figuring out your latitude is actually quite easy. If you're in the northern hemisphere, as these famous cartographers generally were, the star Polaris, known more commonly as the North Star, could be used to determine how far one was from the North Pole. Many different tools have been invented to determine one's latitude, including the astrolabe, sextant, quadrant, theodolite, or whatever else you have to spot stars and measure angles. My personal favorite of these tools, though, has to be the Kamal. This 9th and 10th century Arab invention is literally just a small square piece of wood and a knotted string. The idea here is that the closer to the equator you are, the closer Polaris will appear to the horizon, and the further north you go, the higher up Polaris appears. Thus, holding the string in your teeth, you measure how far you need to put the board away from your face for the bottom to touch the horizon and the top to touch Polaris, using the string to record the measurements. Figuring out your longitude, however, is a lot harder, because the Earth spins, meaning a constellation directly to your east will be directly to your west after only a few hours without you even moving, which is really inconsiderate of the stars if you ask me.
No, actually, the stars are stationary, the Earth just spins in space. Well, if the Earth is spinning around, why don't we feel it? Well, because it's incredibly subtle on that big of a scale, and that's literally not how any of this works. Checkmate, Copernicus!
Thus, in order to track longitude, one thing you would need is an accurate timekeeping device. Hipparchus, in the 2nd century BC, proposed measuring longitude by gathering what times different locations saw solar eclipses. The idea was sound in theory, but ultimately, with the timekeeping technology of the time, didn't seem to go very far. Ptolemy defined the prime meridian as the Fortunate Isles, then the westernmost point of land known to the Roman Empire. Though with no good method of measuring longitude other than how long the roads between different cities were and the angles they would have taken, the shape of the known world might have been alright, but he vastly overestimated how wide the world was. That's not to say the Romans didn't have ingenious ways of measuring distance, they most certainly did, but it's not like you could just draw a straight line across the known world and immediately know how wide Eurasia really is.
A lot of the process, though, was often just making assumptions about what the rest of the world looked like. For example, since ancient Greek times, it was often assumed that there would need to be the same amount of land in the southern hemisphere as in the northern hemisphere in order to keep the world balanced, even though it turns out that's actually nowhere near true. Thus, a lot of infamous map mistakes have been made. From finding the southern end of Baja California and thus assuming the whole thing would be an island, to noticing that apparently every other continent had a great fertile river and assuming Australia would be the same. Oh my god, someone should make a video about that.
When the Age of Discovery update dropped, not only were different parts of the map unlocked to European powers, but new tools were also added to aid in navigation and surveying. The refracting telescope was invented in 1608 and the pendulum clock in 1657, though the latter saw little use at sea because ships also moved side to side. Though these provided huge advantages over dead reckoning, all this allowed for the creation of some of the first true maps of the world. The Europeans obviously weren't alone to the party either. The Arabs and Chinese also made their own world maps, the Arabs even preserving many of the Greek texts we talked about here, and the Polynesians used maps made of sticks and seashells, with the shells representing different islands, and the sticks bent and shaped in certain ways to show how the winds and waves flowed.
Now it's no secret, the precise details on all these maps were incredibly inaccurate, but here's the thing.
Before maybe the 17th century, most maps were often more symbolic than specific. Back then, it was essentially whatever says goes. But here's the thing. Did it really matter? I mean, this lack of specificity didn't really seem to hinder the Greek colonists or Arab explorers or Phoenician traders at all. Now, today we need our maps to be super specific for what we do, but the Romans didn't have super specific borders or satellite communication, so could it be that at the time these maps were essentially good enough? I mean, knowing that Italy's shaped like this and not like this isn't necessarily always as important as knowing you're at least heading toward the right part of Italy. Don't get me wrong though, those super oversimplified medieval TNO maps were a sin.
Hey, did you notice how good all the animations in this video were?
No, not really.
Well, I made those in After Effects. And do you want to know just where I learned how to use After Effects?
Where? Wait, don't hit me with the logo cannon. Skillshare.
Through all the amazing courses you can find on Skillshare.
Huh, you missed me. Ow!
Now, I just started using After Effects after several years of doing absolutely everything in Final Cut Pro. And as difficult as After Effects can be, Skillshare has dozens of classes to help you learn all the different things you can do with After Effects or Photoshop or Illustrator, which I personally found really confusing, as well as more than 20,000 different courses on things completely unrelated to Adobe products, or even computer stuff in general. So if you're not interested in After Effects but still want to learn about photography or cooking or even learning a foreign language, Skillshare is still the place to go. As for which course I'd recommend this video, naturally, I'll again recommend Kutzkazak's course on literally teaching you how they animate their videos, but I'll also recommend Evan Abrams' Introduction to After Effects. So there are courses if you're just starting out or already know a bit. Click the link below to get a free trial of Skillshare Premium when you use the promo code KhAnubis at checkout. But beware, only the first 1,000 people to click the link will be afforded the opportunity.